Hello everyone and welcome back to Around the World in 80 Planes and X-Plane 11. For this flight, I'm in the Carinado Piper Cheyenne 2. This is a payware plane and it certainly looks the part. It's got all the features, nice cabin in the back and fancy seats. And taking a look at the outside, this is what the Piper Cheyenne 2 looks like. Always found it a very sleek plane. I would like the Cheyenne 3, the one with the T-tail is faster, it's got more powerful engines, but this is good too. And I'm going to be flying from Eureka to San Francisco, so finally to San Francisco, and it's a flight of about 217 nautical miles. So without further ado, let me continue to listen to the Apollo 13 audio. We're picking up from a staticky spot. Basically, they're on low bit rate in order to recharge a battery on the command module, I think is the deal. They're dealing with the command module, so. But now he's asking for high bit rate, which is nice. It's quieter. But anyway, here we go.
Our instrumentation and communications officer reports we have high bit rate now.
We're fidgety.
Taking a look at the battery here in mission control to see if we see anything unusual.
Still got lots of good power in this plane.
Battery 2 earlier in the earlier yesterday caused a master alarm to go off. We took a look at it at the time and I could see nothing wrong with it. The battery was put back on the line. And at the time it was...
We didn't really get a good look at Eureka last time.
Rather than a problem with the battery itself.
This way.
Okay, Aquarius, you can go low bit rate, power amp off, and down voice back up now. Voltages and currents look normal on battery too, so...
Okay, Jack, power amp off, back to low bit rate, and I'll go back to sleep.
The battery light staying on.
I think the battery they're referring to in this case is part of the LEM system. But they will eventually be dealing with the command module stuff. But I'm not sure, maybe it's a command module.
Okay, and is the skipper in the sack now?
Let me check a few things inside the cabin.
Skipper in the sack now.
We can save ourselves some RPMs, I'm sure.
Okay, hold on a minute, Jack.
Aquarius, Houston.
Go ahead, Houston.
Okay, Jim, since the antenna switching is kind of annoying, we've talked him into buying, only half of the data. If it gets too troublesome for you to switch antennas, why you just leave it on one antenna and we'll listen to you half of the time.
Okay, it's not really much trouble, that's all we're doing about.
So in front of us there is the city of Eureka, so this, I think the town up there is McKinleyville,
Roger,
closer to the airport.
Looking at what Delta V might have been imparted due to this, and it looks like we're not going to change the PTC attitude.
Okay, there's Delta V imparted. I hope it raised that angle a little bit.
Yeah, we'll be looking at the data here and give you a better answer in the next 30 minutes or so.
Okay.
while back to the drawing board on non-propulsion vents.
The...
And with your kind of luck, it probably lowered the angle some more.
The helium tank had a vent that was designed to release when there was too much pressure, but it was supposed to release in a way that wasn't propulsive, but it did sort of throw them off a bit.
We're going to have a handover here pretty soon, about 3 minutes, so we may lose uplink for 30 seconds or a minute.
Okay.
This is Apollo Control at 109 hours, 27 minutes. Capcom Jack Lausma was advising Jim Lovell that we'll be handing over from the tracking site at Goldstone, California to the Honeysuckle, Australia site in about 3 minutes. During this handover for a period of about 30 seconds to a minute, we will not be able to uplink to the spacecraft. At about 109 hours, 13 minutes, the crew reported a master alarm and a battery light flickering. We had them turn up the, turn on the power amplifier and give us high bit rate data so that we could look at the batteries here on the ground. After a look at them, the Telemu, the LEM, electrical systems engineer,
okay, mission
control,
seems to want to drift right here. Let's not do
that.
In fact, we can go more decisively to the east.
Rather than a problem with the battery itself, and the sensor is triggering the...
We should follow 101 instead of going along the coast. We could just follow the coast down to San Francisco, but 101 is a bit straighter. And so, let's go for that highway right there. Though there are clouds in the way.
Ruptured at about 108 hours, 54 minutes, 40 seconds after reaching a pressure of 1,937 pounds per square inch. Lovell reported at the time seeing particles coming off and also the pressure of the escaping gas, which was thought ahead of time to be was predicted to be a non-propulsive vent, turned out to be very much a propulsive vent. Lovell said that the spacecraft stack, which had been rotating about its longitudinal axis at a rate of about 3 revolutions per hour, this rotational rate was stopped by the vent and
started
pretty
fast.
I'll
have to make sure we don't go too fast.
Rotating about 1 revolution every 2 minutes.
Don't want any more abnormalities.
As compared with a revolution every 18 or 19 minutes in the opposite direction prior to the vent. So the vent was very much a propulsive vent, and hence the remarks from Lovell back to the drawing board on non-propulsive vents.
Let's see what we have here. Oh, that's the autopilot, which we don't use during this series. There is no autopilot use in any of these flights.
Temperatures on
the volume we can set and all that business.
This situation in the span
and some other options. We could change delivery on the fly, apparently.
No problem, either with vehicle temperatures or structure, leaving this rotational rate as it is. And we've advised the crew to let it continue to rotate at that rate. And the only problem might be in switching from one antenna to the other. And this, of course, is a function.
Houston, we're handed over. How do you read?
I say 101 is straighter, but it's still actually pretty curvy. It's just somewhat more direct than following the coast.
Okay, I'm hearing you now, and the noise is going to get better with that.
If not for the clouds, we would be over the Humboldt Redwood State Park, I think.
Okay, that's a lot better, and we figure your battery glitch was just that thermal switch that triggered the caution and warning.
Not sure there are adequate redwood models to populate the area.
Okay, appreciate that.
This is Mission Control. As we were saying, the only problem we, potential problem we could see with the rapid rotation rate, or the more rapid rotation rate of one revolution every 2 minutes, might be that the crew would have to switch from one antenna to the next, and it was felt that this might be troublesome. However, Lovell reported that would be no problem, and they would attempt to keep up with it. In the event that they miss an antenna switch, we would lose data for perhaps 1 minute while the spacecraft rotated around into position for the other antenna to be received on the ground.
That town is Rio Del?
At the present time, Apollo 13 is 140,934 nautical miles from the Earth. Our velocity is up now to 4,700 feet per second. The very gradual velocity buildup we've been seeing since crossing the sphere of influence line, the imaginary line at which the Earth's gravitational force becomes the dominant gravity force acting on the spacecraft, and we begin to see at that point a gradual acceleration due to Earth's gravity.
Okay, Jim, your luck is holding. Tracking shows that your entry angle has gone up to minus 6.24. This is on the basis of all the data we collected between the mid-course up to the time the sheet tank went. So we'll continue to look at it and see if the sheet tank did anything to it at all. So it's the data has gone from 5.9 to minus 6.24.
Yeah, that sounds pretty good. We're getting in there.
Jack in the sack, or is he with you?
Jack and Fred are both trying to sleep. It's rather humorous. Fred's sleeping station now is the tunnel upside down with his head resting on the ascent. Jack's on the floor of the well. But the restraint system wrapped around his arm.
Say, Jack's on the floor and Fred's with his head on the ascent engine.
That's right, with his feet up into the tunnel.
This is Apollo Control at 110 hours, 2 minutes. That was Jim Lovell reporting that Fred Hayes is sleeping at the present time, in a rather unusual position. Fred sleeping with his feet up into the docking tunnel and his head resting on the ascent engine cover, which is on the floor of the LEM, relatively upside down, as viewed in the normal standing position in the LEM, and Jack Swigert sleeping on the floor of the LEM.
Oh, sudden cloud clearing gives us a peek at
hours,
everything around here.
We estimate that the amount of velocity change imparted to the...
Oh, I happen to be tuned to some place. I actually don't want that. Otherwise, we'll have too much sound with the Apollo chatter as well.
Will that tune me?
Gosh, I don't know my VHF stuff. Well, maybe if I just turn those off, it'll be fine.
One revolution every 18 or 19 minutes.
Really hanging in there. Your water's good at 161 hours now.
Hey, that sounds great.
I think we can afford a little bit more speed.
Jack Lyles, Jim Lovell, that our crowd estimates of water would indicate that he's got the crew has sufficient water.
Really looks good in here because the engines are right there.
Command module water.
Not great for looking down. Best plane I remember as far as looking down was like the Maul Orion in Flight Sim 10. That was nice because it had the bottom windows down here. Lots of Piper Cubs and that sort of thing with a lot of bomb windows down there too for bush flying and all, but still, this is nice.
Talking all that over.
There's
now,
one down there still. We continue to follow it.
Okay. Jack Lausman was advising Lovell that we have, as I said before, about 161 hours of water on the LEM ascent descent stage. Based on current consumption rates, and this does not include water which we have available in the command and service module or in the portable life support systems, which would extend that margin somewhat beyond 161 hours. And for some 45 minutes or so, a fairly sizable group, about a dozen people or so, have been gathered around the flight director's console discussing the procedures to be followed during re-entry. Lovell just asked Jack Lausman what procedure was being planned for the oxygen purge systems, the emergency oxygen supply carried with the backpack, and lithium hydroxide canisters available on these. Lausman told him that we haven't reached a conclusion on that. The meeting going on around the flight director's console at this time is involved with that sort of thing, as well as what procedures to be followed as far as jettisoning the LEM and service modules. All of these things being considered and discussed. At the present time, Apollo 13 is 139,164 nautical miles from the Earth, traveling at a speed of 4,745 feet per second. Also like to clarify again the situation with respect to the supercritical helium tank and the burst disk, which ruptured at about 180 hours.
Not 180 hours.
When the pressure got up to some 1937 pounds per square inch. This burst disk is in the tank for the express purpose of keeping pressures from going above levels which the tank can withstand. Had the disk failed to rupture, we had a backup procedure worked out whereby the tank would be vented manually. Of course, it was not necessary to put this backup procedure into effect because the disk ruptured at about the level it was expected that it would. With the burst disk rupturing, what we have effectively lost is the ability to resupply pressure to the tanks as this pressure is drained off by burning the descent propulsion system engine. However, we do have what is called blowdown capability in the engine. That's the pressurization that already exists and which is not lost by depressurizing the supercritical helium tank. This the pressure that is in the propellant tanks remains there. It's isolated from the supercritical helium tank and is not lost when the burst disk ruptures. With this pressurization, we still have some 800 feet per second of delta V remaining and usable in the descent propulsion system engine.
Everything's running real smooth over in Timber Cove, Jim.
Sounds pretty good. How about the Delmonico?
Same, everything's smooth there too.
Good.
lot of people working on the entry procedures, and they'll be continuing to do so. We got a few ideas we'd like to toss at you so you can start thinking about them if you think you're in a position to discuss them without waking up the other guys. What do you think?
Yeah, go ahead. It's okay.
Okay, one of the first things we want to do is charge the battery in the CSM so we can get some limb power over there to do that, and we have procedures ginned up to do it. In regards to the re-entry, we're planning our last mid-course in 5 hours before entry interface.
Nice traffic on the highway there.
That is. And then we'd like to jettison the service module at 4 hours and a half, roughly, before entry interface. And take the next 3 to 3.5 hours for taking pictures, bringing up the command module GNN, taking care of stowage and other odds and ends. And we'd hang onto the LAM until 1 hour before entry interface.
Very windy bit of Highway 101 here.
And these procedures are going to be run integrated in the CMS and LMS tomorrow morning, and hopefully later in the day we'll do it again with Mission Control on the loop. A couple of other things we'd like to toss at you. One question is, what do we do with the OPS? Any thought is that there's adequate O2 in the command module, and that the OPS represents a high pressure source and a stowage problem.
And, well, it looks like the clouds are clearing.
Leaving them in the limb. The other thing is that we think you might want to make this a suited entry, suiting up prior to limb jettison, because what we're doing is when we jettison the limb, like we did in Apollo 10, just let the beauty go. And if we weren't suited by, we'd be betting on the hatch seal to take care of it. So just thought we'd toss a few of these ideas at you. Some of them are ones that are particularly pertinent questions at this time.
Yeah, they could re-enter without their pressure suits on. But they're asking whether they should wear their pressure suits, which is sometimes okay, sometimes not. Oh, we can't really hear his reaction to the suggestion. I feel like if I reduce the density of the trees, it'd cover all of it properly. I think, like, in each patch, it's probably got a limit of how many trees it wants to render. And so it just skips certain squares. I'm thinking that that's what's happening here. Pretty sure the scenery had trees on those squares. It's just... it's deciding not to render them. That's just a guess, though.
I guess the two things are kind of catching what you're saying. The comm is getting kind of bad right now.
Okay.
We're actually a little bit further away from 101 that I wanted.
But if you talk up like that, I think we can hear you.
It's over to the left in that valley over there, I think.
Okay, and maybe you'd like to think over the suited entry bit a little while.
Okay.
Shame the textures look a little bit washed out around here.
Roger, that's one subject that's been getting a lot of attention, and let me see if I can get some general ideas on that at the moment.
Okay.
Jim, I can give you the general idea of the proposed procedure for bringing the command module GNN.
The tree patches are really annoying me, to be honest.
It's a presently proposed one. We may come up with a better one, but here's what we're looking at right now. First thing
I wonder what this thing would do. Let's see.
Using the LEM COAS.
Does it change?
Sight on the earth with the LEM.
Well, it changed something.
Just as we did in the mid-course. Then we'll do a body axis aligned.
Oh, that roadway went away.
To put the eggs ball at 0,
not
0,
much.
0. And then we can give you an eggs ball attitude to fly to. To point the CSM optics at the moon. And if you can see stars, why, we can use those too.
Curious if it has a tree setting in these.
Then we can give you an equivalent set of...
Not in particular, I don't think.
Put into 920 and to torque the platform over. So now we're course aligned. Then we'll do a final line by shooting at the moon and then at the sun.
This town is called Willits? Willits? The airfield is Willits Municipal Airport. Feels a bit hesitant right now, but...
Put it in yet to play.
talk it over a second. We'll tell you what to
do. It's getting a little bit... It must have been loading something. It's conceivable that we're loading the Bay Area, actually, San Francisco.
Jim, is the battery light good?
Because that's about 100 nautical miles away now. I think that's what's going on. We're loading scenery over in San Francisco. I'm taking a look at the moving map in the game. You can see the Northern Bay Area has appeared on the moving map down at the bottom there.
Okay, well, temperature sensor on battery 2 is kind of cycling back and forth, and every time it does, it triggers a master alarm, Jim.
Okay, same old problem, huh?
Yeah. And, Jim, finally on the P-52, we're considering using the moon and then the sun for the final line.
Okay, the moon and the sun for the final line. Yeah, let's go to this again here and see if it's like a 25-foot.
Jim, and then copy your last question due to background noise.
Okay,
this valley area is much more vivid than the surrounding areas. I'd say the valley area is a bit too saturated in the yellow. Yellow reddish.
We can tell you
different time of day is all.
Point the CSM optics at the moon or at some star. And
oops.
Then we can, knowing where the optics are,
we're
pointed,
approaching Ukiah, that's that city
of,
up ahead.
CDU angles to put in now 20 to torque the platform.
You can sort of see in the distance to the left there, Clear Lake, one of the larger lakes. This lake close to us is Lake Mendocino. And this is the city of Ukiah. Can't really hear what he's saying about the command module hatch there.
Time line look too crowded, getting your suits on there at the last minute. say less than an hour before entry interface.
Perhaps a better view of Clear Lake now.
When you decide to get the other guys up or to have someone
I'm not
going to
deviate towards it,
but working on that.
Still following 101 here. Somehow the atmosphere turned to a better color and it's a much better match for the terrain, I think. Some hesitation here.
The second step was
probably more long distance loading. This city in front of us is Cloverdale, and we're entering Sonoma County after being in Mendocino County. And so naturally there is a Lake Sonoma, which is the lake to the right there. Okay, yeah, and it's loading stuff.
Hey, Jack, I have for step 3, I have bat 5 and bat 6, normal feed on. Just one bat 6?
That's affirmative, just bat 6, Jack. And the next line, you had battery 1 and 3. To make that battery 1, 2, 3, and 4, just add bats 2 and 4, all 4 descent bats. And then the next two lines about waiting 30 minutes, cross that out. And the next line about batteries 2 and 4 off reset, cross that out too. And Jack, the...
Okay, let me read.
Go ahead.
Let me read all the steps if I've got them, Jack, and make sure we got them right.
It's all right, Jack, and we had about 11 or 12 steps for the command module. They go as is with no change, and then we had a couple more procedures for the limb, the standby one.
Okay, Jack, let me read the command module for you. I have them right also.
Okay, go ahead with the command module procedures.
Okay, connect LIMP CFM umbilical. Step 2, panel 5, CV, LIMP power 1, AC, and 2, AC, flow. Circuit breaker. Step 3, panel 5, CV, CFM signal, AC, flow. Step 4,
this town is Healdsburg. And beyond
okay,
it is Windsor.
Jack, the CSM procedure is okay, and then we had to go back to the limb and do something. And the first line is okay. Cross out bat 5 and 6 off. Delete that. And delete the next line also that says panel 1116 SNECA control open. And then we had a couple of notes which remain the same. Go ahead.
Okay, I didn't get the notes, but I'll read the steps as I have them now. One step. Pass 1, 3, and 4, high voltage on. So we'll have, at this point, we'll have batteries 1, 3, 4, and 6 on. Is that correct?
That's affirmative. So now we've got bat 1, 2, 3, 4, and 6 on. And I've got two notes. Number one is... circuit breaker protection limit. Your circuit breaker protection limits the current to 15 amps. Number two note is now the umbilical between a limb and a command module is hot. And the main bus voltage can be monitored by selecting main B.
Okay, Jack, these notes are circuit breaker protection limits current to 15 amps. Note 2, the umbilical between the CFM and LAMP is hot. I can monitor me.
So below us is Windsor. This is Sonoma County Airport. And the large city in front of us is Santa Rosa.
Okay.
negative, Jack. According to the latest update, we've got ampere hours out to 203 hours.
Okay, Jack, one question from Jim is he wants to know whether the procedure has been tried.
Okay, try it again now, Jack. What does Jim want to know?
In the distance to the right is Point Reyes National Seashore. And it is Santa Rosa.
Okay, Jack, this procedure has not been tried out as such. However, the hardware path through which the current flows are the same ones which we used during translunar trajectory, and there's not a problem with shorting out a descent battery, over. Jack, of course, the reason for all this is that we see we're 20 amp hours short on one of the entry batteries, and we've got to juice that up to get you home with.
Okay.
Okay, now what we owe you from here on out is the actual battery A charge procedure, and then a procedure to turn this all around again.
The city we can see up ahead with the buildings there is Petaluma.
Okay, do you have it there? And I don't know how long it is.
Down below us is Rohnert Park.
Okay, Jack, I have the procedure in front of me.
Oh, I might be wrong. The
18 steps.
Wait a second.
And the reason it's so long is because...
That's Santa Rosa.
From this basic configuration which we gave you earlier.
It should be Rohnert Park.
And it concerns a charge and battery A, of
I think
course,
that's Petaluma.
Which is our low one. So when you're ready to copy it, let me know.
Okay, let's plan it.
Yeah. Yeah, Petaluma. And that's the North Bay that we're seeing.
Okay, you ready to read or copy it?
You can almost see the Richmond-San Rafael Bridge there.
Several circuit breakers around panel 5. Circuit breaker, bat relay bus, bat A, close. Circuit breaker, EPS sensor unit, AC bus 2, close. CB, EPS sensor signal, AC 2, close. CB, battery charger, main B, close. You still with me?
Okay, Jack, I'll read back those steps that you gave me so far. Panel 250, CB, battery, power, entry, and one landing, close. Panel 75, CB, turner power, AC, close. Panel 5, CB, battery, A, close. CB, EPS,
good read back, Jack. The only one is number one, number four. I didn't get your read back, but it's EPS sensor unit AC bus 2 closed. You got that?
Yes, I read that back.
Okay, to continue on the same panel, panel 5. Circuit breaker, battery charger, AC power, closed. Circuit breaker, battery charger, bat A charge, closed. Circuit breaker, inverter control 2. Close.
The city is Novato.
Circuit breaker, inverter control 3.
That airport down there is Marin County Airport.
And I got a switch for you. Main bus tie.
We can see San Francisco. Some buildings there. Richmond Centerfield Bridge is barely distinct to there.
I got a switch for
tough
you.
To see it, actually.
AC inverter 2.
It is just AC. Basically a causeway, though.
Okay, AC inverter 2 to main B.
Okay, and switch. Inverter 2. AC bus 2. Switch AC bus 2 reset to reset and center. Switch battery charge to alpha. Switch DC indicator select bat charger. And then what we want you to do is to report the charger current and voltage to Miss Finn every 10 minutes for the first half hour, and then once every 30 minutes after that. And that'll be on our call, Jack. Read back the switches I just gave you.
Center, bat charger.
We're over Mill Valley. And we see Sausalito in front of us. Very nice version of Sausalito, and of course the Golden Gate Bridge, the Bay Bridge, at least the western portion of it is visible. Some hints of the eastern portion, and of course San Francisco there. We've got a twitchy carrier, it looks like. Golden Gate Bridge and the Presidio.
Which will put us back to 193 hours. And that's plenty.
Alcatraz Island to our left. Model of the eastern portion clearly isn't there.
Stand by one.
For the Bay Bridge. And the western portion. And then a random carrier there. Old style carrier. Or no, that's a container ship, sorry. That's a container ship. I'm so used to seeing random carriers all over the place. There's definitely one here somewhere. I just saw one. Oh, maybe it disappeared. Golden Gate Park.
Okay, Jack, are you with me?
Yeah, we're still here, Jack. What we want to do is follow you through on this, so we're going to get a high bit rate to do it. In answer to your question, to undo this procedure quickly in the event a problem develops, be sure that you don't touch the limb power switch, because that's got a reset position. But the way to undo it is to go into the CSM and on panel 5, open two circuit breakers. And they're some of the first ones we read to you. Open limb power 1, main B, and open limb power 2, main B. You copy that?
Okay. I want to get out of this real quickly. I have to open just two circuit breakers in the CSM. That's on panel 5. Left power 1 main B, left power 2 main B.
Okay, and before you go ahead with this, let's establish a high bit rate and wait one on that. And then as we go through the procedure, we want you to wait when you get power on main B, so that we can take a look at main B without any loads on it before we start charging the battery.
Oh, we seem to have some winds.
Okay.
Okay, Jack, before we go ahead with this, what we want to do is read you the normal reverse procedure.
Well, time to go into the cockpit.
Okay, and I'm ready to copy.
reverse this procedure. You ready to copy it?
Go ahead, Jack.
Okay, first you want to reverse the battery charge procedure. To do that, on panel 3, switch, battery charge, off. AC inverter 2, off. Panel 5.
Okay, a bit of flaps.
Main bus tie.
Landing gear.
Charlie. On up. Panel 250. Circuit breaker. Bat Alpha. Power entry and post landing. Open. Read back.
Way too high.
Okay, Jack, go back to the
there is some wind going on.
And in order to terminate charge, just you'll just have to write opener off next to the circuit breaker switch that I gave you. So on panel 250. That circuit breaker you've already opened. On panel 275, inverter power 2 main B, open. Panel 5, bat relay bus bat A, open. EPS sensor unit AC bus 2, open. EPS sensor signal AC 2, open. Battery charger
very high.
Open. Battery charger AC power open. Charger bat A charge open. Inverter control 2 open. Inverter control 3 open. You've already done the main bus tie. And then bat charge. Switch to AC 1.
Okay.
You have already.
This is a happy taxiway or? Well, it is the one I have chosen. Oh, funny sounds. Well, SFO is looking pretty good. And we have arrived. As usual, not concerned about clearance or anything like that. But anyway, as I approach the terminal, let's take a look. And yeah, let me pause right there as they continue to sort things out. And with this, I'll say thank you for watching. I hope you enjoyed this flight. If you did, please do press like. If you have any comments or suggestions, please leave them in the comment section below. And I'll see you next time.